sky cascading, the colors are infinite.
Good afternoon and welcome to another Old Georgian V-Talk. And today we're going to be joined by Alan Kirkaldy, I hope I pronounced it correctly, from 1976. And before we hand over to Alan, a short note from the archives. In 1858, Reverend George Ogilvy was appointed the headmaster, and during his short reign from 1858 to 1861, he started the senior section of the school, as it was called then, the high school, and grew the school with his inspirational leadership. And in 1861, Bishop Robert Gray appointed him as the head of the Diocese College Bishops, where he remained for 25 years, which is quite interesting. And he is credited with introducing rugby and chess into South Africa. So there's a bit of an interesting fact from the early days of St. George's Grammar School. But today we're joined here by Alan Kirkaldy from 1976. He had his whole school career with us from 1966 to 1976, from Form 1 to Matric. And during his time, he was involved with the Naval Cadets. And in his in Form 10, final year, grade 12, he achieved the Ian Fairweather History Prize. For the grade. Since leaving St. George's, he's written a number of books, one of which was a fishing community in Kalk Bay. I have not much information about it, but I'm hoping to get my hands on it and give it a squiz. At present, Alan is at Rhodes University. He teaches African history, environmental history, and the history of liberation movements. So we welcome Alan, and over to you.
Hi, thanks very much for inviting me. It's very nice to be here. And I hope I manage to actually get back to the school sometime. I haven't been since I've left, so it would be nice to come down again sometime. I still have the book, by the way, the Ian Fairweather History Prize. It's floating around in our sitting room at home. I still refer to it every now and then. It in fact was, I bought a book in zoology rather than history. But I still use it every now and then. And my son is a zoologist and he's made use of it as well. So yeah, it was a very useful acquisition. So I was kind of dithering what to talk about for the talk, and I decided that the late thing to talk just because it's the most recent and maybe it'll persuade somebody to buy it. But for a book about communists, it's actually ridiculously priced. So I don't think many people are going to be buying it. I can assure you, I don't make the money. The publishers make the money. I already have I took a one-off royalty. So I know exactly how much I made out of the book. And I worked out yesterday, they've actually made more money than me by far already. But it's the intricacies of academic publishing. you don't expect to make lots of money out of academic books, especially books on communists, I suppose. Okay, I'll hold up the book. Hardcover, and it's published overseas, and that makes it very expensive. Oops, I'm getting. It's very unusual for us. So we do have backup generators, though. So if anything goes wrong, we should be fine. Okay, if you're involved in the field of liberation struggles, as I am, and do we need another book on white communists? Because Fishers and everybody's kind of read about them and is bored of them, to be honest. Their story was worth telling, and in fact, you know, when you publish a book, if you publish it academically, they send it out for blind peer reviews, which I still don't know who read the book in those days. They send it to three readers. They subsequently send it to more, but in the beginning, they could consider this or don't even touch it. It's a report by saying, when I saw this, I thought, oh, not another book on white communists. And yeah, I think certainly for one reader anyway, well, so I think others have also. It kind of came across in a weird way that dive in Grahamstown called the old. I used to hang out there with my students after lectures. I found out whose name was Lesley was equally worth studying, and as I say, in some ways, even more worth studying. So there they are again. That's Ivan and that's Lesley. That's Lesley over there. And I worry about many of the biographies that have come out since 1994 in South Africa. They kind of focus on these heroes of the struggle, and they paint these kind of iconic pictures of these larger than life characters. And which I do, you tend not to focus on big luminaries, you tend to focus on ordinary people. And so I kind of worry about the biography, not that I don't respect people like Bram Fischer and Joe Slover, but you know, these are the kind of poster boys of the struggle. Even Ruth First has been largely forgotten about. These are kind of the icons of the struggle, the Mandelas and so on as well. And we kind of forget about the ordinary people who were actually what made the struggle happen. You know, the struggle couldn't have happened without the foot soldiers. And one of the reviewers have said, I undermine the concept of foot soldiers by the fact that these people were far from foot soldiers. But they weren't the big publicly known heroes of the struggle. They were members of the Central Committee of the Communist Party, which means they weren't kind of just ordinary everyday people. The original title of the final title was Everyday Communists. They were a bit more than that in some ways, but in other ways, they were never in the public eye. Ivan kind of worked for a series of communist newspapers, and Lesley officially ran an exercise business. She's quite interesting. She's one of the first personal trainers in South Africa, and she carried on as a personal trainer. I've got Bitcoin on the brain at the moment. She hung in there as a personal trainer right until COVID. So she's only recently stopped training people. And for a historian, I'm notoriously bad at dates. So I actually have to check. Ivan was born on the 22nd of February, 1921 in the Transkei. And Lesley was born in Zululand in 1926. What's quite interesting is the Communist Party of South Africa was formed in 1922. So their life histories kind of parallel the development of the Communist Party. And they were members of the party at significant stages in its development. Many other people that have the children of Ada, and in her case, a trader in Zululand, they grew up on missions on trading stations in and they grew up speaking in and this is Zulu as very much parallel languages. I don't want to say first or second languages, because they grew up speaking English and African languages together, which set them aside from, I mean, Joe Slovo, you know, couldn't speak an African language. So they grew up with a bond to local people that many of the other struggle heroes that we've come to hear about didn't have, and a kind of access to people that many of the other people didn't have, because they they kind of had these backgrounds where you didn't expect them to become struggle heroes. They were in the struggle. They could have done what most of their contemporaries did and gone on. But both of them kind of developed and they grew up with kind of black players in a society where those kind of relations that they had with the people they grew up, they were growing up. Once they started going to school and things, they were supposed to sever these relations. Carried on. The Second World War played a major role in conscientizing both of them and giving what was this kind of to a kind of ideology, which happened to be a socialist or communist ideology. It could, segregation, stroke apartheid at this stage, was really provided by the Communist Party, which was very racist when it was first formed. In 1922, it had as its slogan, white workers of the world. It was only later on in its history that the organization were both conscientized during the Second World War, where they the newspapers. Lesley was, as I say, running an exercise business. but was doing things like distributing the newspapers and going to cell meetings, they kind of almost inevitably got together at a dance. And kind of decided, well, okay, we're kind of going to struggle things together. Let's make it a partnership. And there's this picture that's been portrayed of the left in South Africa as this kind of immoral nature, supposedly, of they had this very firm and very faithful relationship. What was interesting is, and you know, as I said, they both achieved positions on the central committee. So on one level, they weren't in the background, but nobody out of the Central Committee knew about them. And essentially, Ivan started an organization called the odd way of raising struggled funds. But that he worked campus, which was a way of workers putting aside money every month so that they'd have money for a hamper at Christmas, was what funded the underground activities of the Communist Party. Financial brains behind myths about Moscow gold, that the struggle was funded by Moscow. Funding from Moscow was never as great as we came in later. It was essentially the Christmas moving around the countryside. People, the underground struggle. So this is the side of the struggle that called everyday communists. The fact that they were communists every day and they were ordinary everyday people as well. But is they kind of hit small business people and they gave whatever they could. They kind of collected money all over the place, and that's what was funding the struggle. That was what was funding, you know, the 50. That was what was funding them after the Communist Party became illegal. Once the party became illegal and repressive legislation began to where was the game with that? I do sometimes lose my train of, it was in, that was the only way of raising funds. And two, people started being moved out of the country to avoid security legislation. The country was Lesley. So you essentially had Ivan raising the money that funded the struggle, the organization that was funding people to move out of the country, either for military training or to go very much in the background. These were kind of illegal activities, and they carried on like this. Went underground. There's all these romantic stories about the Bram Fischer managed to survive underground. It was Lesley that was actually moving him around in that. Disguises for him and so on. So, jail. Okay. Ivan spent 5 years in jail. They spent lengthy periods after that under restrictive banning orders. authorized once they came out of jail to go into exile. Both of them refused to go into exile. They said our place is in South Africa. That's where the struggle is. We need to stay here. It's easy for white communists to move out. It's not easy for black communists to move out. We need to remain here to show solidarity. And they're in fact quite bitter about some of the people who did leave and go into exile. Their kind of cover was blown by then. After you've been in prison, you know, it's fairly obvious that you're known communists. So they both wanted to go back to party work, but they couldn't go back to overt party work because the party kind of said, no, you know, we can't use you anymore because you're hidden. Because you're exposed. So what they did was they essentially campaigned to raise funds to alleviate the plight of political prisoners and to organize visits for political prisoners and so on. So they became kind of the social workers of the movement in another way. And that was very often a thankless task. But they organized that the political prisoners would have visitors. They organized that funds could be raised for them. So, you know, for me, this is very much a background role they were always playing, but these background roles were crucial. And I think that's what we often forget about in these big histories where we kind of valorize people and praise their contribution to the struggle, is that the struggle was made up of lots of ordinary people doing very small things, although in their case, maybe they weren't so small. But, you know, people contributed in the way they did. And the index of the book is very long because I tried to put in the index everybody that's not mentioned in the conventional histories of the Communist Party. So, yes, Joe Slovo does appear. Bram Fischer does appear. Ruth First does appear. But hundreds of previously unknown or lesser known communists also appear in the index. Because, you know, my argument is that it's these everyday people that make a revolution, whatever that revolution means. And that to achieve any kind of political change, it's the struggles and the contributions of those very ordinary people that matter. Obviously, you need the big public spokespeople. But without the kind of everyday workers, the behind-the-scenes people, the backroom people, you're not going to get anywhere. So for me, that's the strength of couples like this, and why I felt, and in fact, why the readers felt, that a biography of this nature was still okay. And then what I also tried to do was kind of, biographies have either focused in the past on the lives of the people, or they focused on the political movement. I tried to tie the two together. So there's very much articles on the development, or so chapters on the development of the struggle, but there's also the personal history. What's quite interesting is talking to people who've read the book, some people have said, we really like the biography part, and other people have said, we really like the kind of struggle history part. A few have said, which is what they're supposed to do, we like both parts. I must admit, the biography is more fun. The kind of, you know, and then of the struggle. Okay, some of it hasn't been written about before, but we kind of, those of us who've studied it know this stuff. But the kind of everyday, the quirks of business. For instance, one of the things that certainly appeals to my wife the most, and secretly, it appeals to me the most, is that Lesley was holding underground meetings of the people that were moving Bram Fischer around when he was in hiding in the cloakroom of John Orr's in Joburg, in the ladies' bathroom. So what they would do is they would go there and they would have cake and coffee and things. And then they'd all retire to the bog. And while they were in the toilet, they'd be planning about where they could move him next. Had they met in some known communist house, they would have been spied on by the special branch. Nobody suspected that these women, and she came to a presentation I did once, and she emphasized, and we wore hats. There were these women wearing hats and gloves who were plotting revolution in the toilet. And to me, that typifies how political change happens. It's not always women wearing hats and gloves or in the toilet, but it's that kind of behind the scenes stuff. And for me, that's what's fun about it. I mean, I hope that people that read it will enjoy reading. That's the purpose of the book, is that it should be enjoyable and it should be fun. Besides kind of exposing, I mean, there's a lengthy series preface, which is very erudite. In fact, I think it's more erudite. It's written by sort of five respected academics saying why the book is significant. And I'm very glad they wrote that rather than me, because it's kind of a nice story and it's got some nice history. And some of the history wasn't known before, but some of it was known before, but it ties it together in new ways. And so, yeah, I like to hope it fills a gap. And I suppose if there's any questions, I'll answer. But that is, in essence, a summary of it. Yeah.
Alan, that sounds like a very interesting story or fascinating story, and it must have taken you down some interesting paths of research, having to put it together and discovering things you didn't know before. To put it all together.
The research process is, for me, the most interesting. Writing is a slog. I mean, I've written a few books now and it never gets any easier. Writing is a slog. It's a kind of discipline that you have to serve. Thank God for COVID, okay? Because I managed to, I've been working on this book since 2010. I managed to finish it last year because of COVID lockdown. So I could kind of lock myself away. I was teaching on Zoom, so I didn't have students knocking at my door, and I could actually sit down and do the discipline of writing. But the research process is the fun thing, because I traveled all over the countryside. I met kind of interesting people in all sorts of places. And, I've got a lot of experience of interviewing people. Now, I have a Communist Party history of my own, and people in the party are wary of speaking to me sometimes, because they kind of either think they know what I want to hear, or they don't agree with what I think, or they think they may not agree, but there's this kind of, well, or they think, yeah, he just knows that. Why should we talk about this? And the big bugbear in communist history in South Africa is the role of Stalinism. The Communist Party of South Africa for most of its life was intensely Stalinist. And Stalinism was, if we want good things and bad things, Stalinism was a bad thing. So it's very embarrassing. And if you want to shut an old commie up, ask him about Stalinism and he won't say another word to you. Okay. And I've never found a way around that except writing this book, because I'm used to, believe it or not, for a historian, I can't read maps. I'm physically incapable of reading a map. I can use garments, okay? That when the thing talks to me, I can. But I needed maps to get around, to go and hunt out old commies. And my son is, who's a paleo entomologist, he studies fossilized bugs. He's very good at reading maps. Okay. So I took him along to read the maps for me. I kind of get very nervous. I've always lived in small towns after I left Cape Town. So driving in Joburg and places like that freaks the hell out of me. So I would be freaking out in the car and he'd be kind of looking at a map and saying, turn left, turn right. And we'd get to these places, and he was a lot younger then. He wasn't yet a paleoentomologist. He had just left school. And they'd kind of say, well, you sit over there, Ben, and you have, you know, they're, old commies are very good at giving you coffee and cakes if you're a child. Okay. So they'd sit him down in a corner with coffee and cakes, and they'd talk to me, and they'd skirt aside on all the issues I actually wanted them to open up on. And then I promise you it wasn't really a tactic I used on purpose, but Ben got interested in what they were saying. And he'd say, sorry, what happened there? And they kind of thought, shit, sorry. here's a young guy interested in what we did. And they'd tell him all the things they wouldn't tell me. Because here was this young guy who was now interested in their kind of, you remember, these are now old people who kind of, the struggle's over, they're kind of old, and quite a few have died since then. You know, they're kind of nearing this. Here's a young guy that wants to hear. It's not me who they kind of think they know or don't know, but don't want to know. And here's this young guy who's interested. So let's tell him. And I mean, I got all kinds of insights that I would never have got. So it taught me all sorts. Every research project you do, you learn new tricks about how to do research. And I mean, it genuinely wasn't a trick. I didn't prime Ben and say, you know, go. And there's also just sort of really, you know, Lesley herself only eats raw vegetables. So she's incredibly gaseous. I mean, she's a kind of walking fart machine. And I would be trying to interview Lesley with this kind of 17-year-old boy having fits of giggles in the corner, because Ben would just like, so the research process is the fun part of doing it. And yeah, writing up, as I say, is a slog.
It's fascinating and very rewarding that you're capturing the stories of the smaller heroes, if that's a term to be used, the lesser known heroes, and freedom fighters that they are. So to get these stories down in paper and to be recorded is something that I think we need to do more of as the generations start to get older, because there's always something interesting to find out, and that feeds into the greater story, as you've said, that these lesser known figures were very integral in moving the bigger picture forward. So to capture their stories is fantastic.
As I said, many have now unfortunately passed away. You know, sorry to say, gone gaga. Some of them, you know, their stories are not going to be told.
So to capture it while they are alive, that's great. And get to meet those people. That must be one of the most rewarding parts, is for you to actually sit down with them and have a cup of tea and try and get out the information that you're needing or would like to hear, that they're sometimes a bit cautious of sharing.
Yeah. And it has its intimidating moments. I presented at an international history conference. I presented in the early stages of the book, and I kind of invited the family to come, because they're still, Ivan's dead, but Lesley's still around. And I invited them to come. And I looked up as I started presenting, and there was this row of elderly communists sitting looking at me. And it's about the most intimidating thing I've ever had. You're kind of presenting with the people that you're presenting about, sitting looking at you. As part of the centenary celebrations of the Communist Party, last year I did a webinar where, in true communist style, Lesley infiltrated the meeting. Okay, I looked at the list of participants. I always look at the list of participants when I enter a Zoom meeting, just to identify possible landmines. And I looked down the list of participants, and Lesley wasn't there. Luckily, I didn't set out to assassinate her character. I mean, she's the main character in the book, you know, or one of the two main characters. But I spoke, and I got a phone call sort of 10 minutes after I had finished presenting, saying, I was there. She was there under somebody else's Zoom.
Oh, no. Great. And I'd like to just divert the conversation a bit and to dig it or to ask a little bit or chat a bit about your hobbies. You've got quite an interesting group of hobbies there. The one is your karate hobby, and the other is a practicing bladesmith.
Yes, funny enough, the bladesmithing grew out of the karate, because I started martial arts when I was still at St. George's, actually. I don't know if they still have judo. We had judo at the school when
Have judo with with Sensei. So yeah, she's still here and they still do have judo.
Right, yeah. And then in high school, there was a period where there was no judo and I moved into karate, which I did in Tal. But I've carried on with karate since then. And over the years with karate, I've got more interested in weapons, which although it means empty hand, funnily enough, there's a lot of scope for weapons, because they teach you about the body and they teach you about distancing and all sorts of things. And I got particularly interested in iaido, which is the fast drawing of the sword, which is quite fun. If you draw a katana properly, it kind of makes a noise. It doesn't just come out and kind of goes whoosh. And then I kind of thought, well, you can't wave these things around unless you know how they're made. And I got interested in, well, how do you, so I went to YouTube, as we all do nowadays, okay? And I made a couple of really disastrous blades, because, you know, the YouTube, I remember one of the first videos I watched, I was dutifully taking notes. I still work on paper, so taking notes throughout the whole thing. And at the end of the video, the point of his blade melted off. And I thought, I've just wasted an hour writing notes, and now the end of his blade has fallen off. So I went on a bladesmithing course. Oh. I like to say I went to Belfast, which sounds very romantic, but it's Belfast in Mpumalanga rather than in Ireland. But in fact, we're fortunate enough, we have, in as far as I know, I'm still accurate, there's only one master bladesmith certified internationally on the African continent, and there's a couple, and they are in Belfast. And I went and did a bladesmithing course with them. And so for what? It's probably about 12 years now. I've extensively been making blades. They're constantly on the go. So I probably can't tell you how many I've made, but I kind of, you know, when I go home this afternoon, I'm first having a COVID test. and then I'm going home to finish. I'm making 8 steak knives for us at the moment. So I'm on number 7's handle I finished yesterday. So I just need to finish polishing it and then stick it in with the others. So I make mainly blades that you can use. So kitchen knives, but I also make things like hunting knives. And funny enough, I don't make katanas at the moment. I've got a commission to make a wakizashi, the sword that goes with the katana. And I keep holding off on it. I keep looking at a wakizashi, and it will happen this year sometime. But, you know, a blade can take, even a kitchen knife can take 6 months to make. So,
sure.
You know, when you sell them, people can say, you always undersell, because you can't actually get what they're worth.
Mm.
But people say, why does it take, when, you know, I can go and buy a knife at Clicks for 29 Rand. Well, you know, go and buy a knife at Clicks for 29 Rand. It will also cut, but yes, yeah.
No, I must say, it's one of the most interesting hobbies I have heard anybody have, is being a practicing bladesmith to creating knives. So well done on that there. And
the nice thing is, if you teach at a university, I teach the Iron Age. So amongst other things. So
that's a nice.
I always have an excursion into forging of, yeah. And it means that on Facebook, you'll see I always have ex-students who are now making blades with me, because I get first-year students who come and say, I would like to make a knife. And yes, yeah, they end up, some of them sort of 10 years later are still making knives with me.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
Well, Alan, thank you so much for your time and sharing your story. And please, when you are in Cape Town again, get in contact with us. We'd love to host you here at the school for a bit and take you on a tour of how things have grown and changed since last year, but yet still stayed very much the same. So yes, again, thank you again for joining us and sharing information on your book.
Thanks for inviting me. And please add me. I used to get links, but I don't seem to get them anymore to the
Old Georgians.
The series,
follow up on that one, because I see you asked on the list, but I will follow up and check what's going on.
Sorry, I'm terrible at email. Maybe I missed them. I'll certainly flag them more than I used to.
And I look forward to trying to get my hands on a copy of the book in the future. We'll see what we can do about getting a copy. Maybe
I'll certainly bring you the Venda one down.
Thank
and
you.
Unfortunately, the Kalk Bay one is out of print.
Thank you. It'll be a great addition to the Old Georgian collection of books there. And good luck with your COVID test.
Thank you very much. Yes. But enough, I feel fine.
Becoming a formality nowadays, having a test.
Great. Well, thanks a lot. Yeah.
Thanks again. And we'll definitely connect and chat again soon.
Yeah, great. Thanks. Stay well. See you.
Keep well. Bye-bye.